This is the holy grail of Galashiels legends. A myth which sits high in the hills above Galashiels. A story which most people from Galashiels think they know, but few really do. A story with connections to other border towns which are largely unknown. This is the generally accepted story of Dobies Grave. Our story starts here, in the royal borough of Lauder. The year is 1790. Remember that year, there's a significance to it later. But our hero from Galashiels, Dobie the Piper, was in Lauder for a harvest celebration where he was playing the pipes. Celebrations went on into the night. Dobie had a few drinks, a bit of merriment, when some guys from Lauder made Dobie a bet. "We bet you canny walk all the way from Lauder to Gala playing the pipes continuously." Now, how could Dobie, a good Galashiels man, possibly refuse a bet like that? So he took the bet. So full of confidence, full of bravado, full of whiskey, who knows, but determined to make his bet, our protagonist Dobie trudged here to the outskirts of Lauder and began his mammoth trek over the hills and moors to Galashiels. Tragically, our brave, drunk maybe, however you want to describe him, Piper never made it back to Galashiels. At this point here, on Laddup Moor, a mere 2 or 3 miles from his beloved Galashiels, he dropped down dead. Exhaustion, heart attack, who knows, but it was here that he died. And it was here that he was also buried. And this cairn, this huge cairn, is a monument that marks the spot of Dobie's grave. And for centuries now, in Galashiels, it's been a landmark on the hills above Galashiels, Dobie's grave. So, I'd love to tell you now that's the end of the story. We can look back on this incident with maybe a little bit of pride, maybe a bit of sadness for this man Dobie and his exploits, and you know, we can come here and pay our respects. But there are flaws in the story, and there are connections elsewhere in this story that I want to investigate. This afternoon, I've managed to catch up with Galashiels ex-service pipe band veteran, Drew Ness. Afternoon, Drew.
Good afternoon.
So, as you know, Drew, we're investigating this Dobie's grave. 1790 is the year. Can you tell me
what Galashiels ex-service pipe band was like in 1790.
Well, in 1790 there was no such thing as a pipe band. It was into the mid-1800s before the army started having pipe bands, and probably the late 19th century before civilian pipe bands came on the scene.
Right.
The Galashiels band was formed in 1901.
1901, 120 years after the supposed incident.
Yeah.
So the image that most people have, including myself, Dobie, is tartan dress, big Highland bagpipes. Is that realistic, or what would Dobie have looked like?
Well, in the borders, which I would have said it would have been border pipes,
yeah,
which would have been bells blowing,
uh-huh,
with the right arm. I doubt very much if back in 1790 Highland pipes would have been played in the borders at all.
So the whole image, Dobie, member of the pipe band, Highland outfit, bagpipes, is probably wrong.
I would say that was the case.
So we know that you're a bit of a musical or a bagpipe expert, Drew, and you've got some examples. Would it be possible to have a look at one of these bellows-driven pipes today?
Yes, I have two sets of pipes here.
Mm-hmm.
One is the border pipes, and the other is the Scottish small pipes. And this is the bellows that, in this case, for handiness, I have the border pipes bellows that work both sets. They were the pipe that the town pipers, or sometimes a learned gentry,
mm-hmm,
a duke or somebody like that, would have a piper as well. And they played bellows type pipes, like the border pipes. This is the Scottish small pipes, as they've now become known.
Uh-huh.
They were probably a forerunner of the Northumbrian pipe, which is quite an advanced instrument. And this is a more simple instrument.
So, yeah, I think that's dispelled a few myths there about Dobie. So the image that certainly the image that I had in my head of Dobie has been changed a bit because of that.
Yes, I think at the end of the day, mm-hmm, we've just all accepted, over the years, we've just accepted the fact that,
yeah,
there was a grave there.
Aye.
I have reservations that back in 1790 there would still be strict on things like deaths and burials.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't think anybody would just have been buried
chucked
where they supposedly.
Yeah. Seems to be a few flaws in the story, I think. But anyway, Drew, thank you very much for your time today, and I think you've certainly put us clear on a few wee things there. Thank you. So, we decided to do a bit of digging, see if we could find any solid facts about Dobie in the register of births, deaths and marriages. Now, unfortunately, the register of births, deaths and marriages at Scottish Borders Council only goes back to 1851. So, we couldn't find Dobie there, obviously. But we didn't stop there. We then got access to the old parish registers, the old parish records kept deep in the vaults of churches all over the borders, which have now been digitised. So we searched for Dobies in Galashiels area in the whole of Selkirkshire. Nothing. Couldn't even find one Dobie surname. Now, deaths are not very common to be registered in these parish records, but births are, so we looked for Dobie births in Galashiels. Nothing. Dobsons, there were lots of Dobsons, but not a single Dobie registered birth in Galashiels. So we could find no mention of a Dobie in any of the statistical records for Galashiels or the parish of Selkirkshire. So the next historical document we decided to look at were maps. There are loads of highly detailed maps from the 1800s of the Galashiels area. But guess what? Not a single one of these OS maps had any mention of Dobies Grave. In fact, the first time we see Dobies Grave appearing on any OS map is in the OS map of 1902, some 112 years after the event was supposed to have happened. So those are the flaws in the Galashiels Dobie's Grave story. But what is it I'm trying to say? That the whole story is made up? A product of someone's imagination? No. My theory is far more complex and mysterious and hopefully interesting than that. And my theory has brought me here to the lonely valley between Innerleithen and Heriot. Site of another piper's grave. So this anonymous piper's grave in the middle of nowhere between Innerleithen and Heriot bears a legend similar to Dobie's grave. The piper was going from Traquair to Edinburgh Castle when he dropped down dead on the spot here and was buried. But that whole legend has been completely debunked in the 1990s when old parish records were discovered from Peebleshire, documenting this as an actual incident. But the piper was not going from Traquair to Edinburgh Castle. He was going from Peebles to where else? Lauder. Coincidence? I think we maybe need to go and have another look at those parish records for births and deaths, but this time for Innerleithen and Peebleshire instead of Galashiels. So we managed to get access to the old parish records for Peebleshire and Innerleithen. This is Traquair Kirk. Now deaths, as with Galashiels, deaths are simply not recorded on these parish records. There are no death records. But we looked at births again and searched the name Dobie. And wouldn't you know it, there is one Dobie birth recorded in this parish. A Samuel Dobie. But the thing which is even more interesting is the date of Mr. Dobie's birth. And that date is 1790. The date which has been bound about for the Dobie story from Galashiels as well. Another coincidence. So is it conceivable then that Dobie's grave in Galashiels and the piper's grave near Innerleithen are both monuments to the same man, the same incident, the same story, the same legend? And do both these monuments remember this one man, this Samuel Dobie from near Innerleithen. It's a bit of a leap of faith, but I'll let you decide. It makes you beg the question, why would the people of Galashiels, or some people from Galashiels, want a piper's grave in the hills above the town? Well, there are other instances of piper's graves in the borders. This is the small village of Ednam near Kelso. And this is another piper's grave. The story is a piper from Ednam came out in the hills to play the pipes. He was taken away by fairies, and this giant piece of stone here marks the exact spot where he was buried. Not at all associated with the Galashiels or Innerleithen one. But it's made up. This site here was actually a Bronze Age burial site. Three huge stone coffins were found here. This is the lid of one of the coffins, but it was left here as a marker. But it just shows you the power of the piper's grave mythology. People wanted that associated with their town. Pipers were seen in the old days, the medieval times, as a bit spiritual, a connection between this world and the spirit world. Perhaps a lot of that has stemmed from the Pied Piper at Hamelin. We all know the fairy tale, the piper who took away the rats and then abducted 130 children. But what people don't know is that's a true story. And from that day, the myth and the spirituality of pipers was a big thing across the whole of Europe. And it was probably seen as a bit of a status symbol for a town to have a piper's grave in the hills, mysteriously lurking over the town. So there you go. Probably more questions than answers about the legend of Dobie's grave. Now believe me, nothing would please me more than if somebody was to turn up with some proof, some real evidence that Dobie was a real man from Galashiels and cement the story as a real story. But as for now, we don't have that, and we'll just have to hang on to the points that I've raised today.